Welcome to today's Science Talk, Space, Body and Brain. My name is Pernilla Berg, Science Manager at Bloxhub, and I'm your hostess for today. It is a delight to welcome you to our fourth Science Talks in our series on healthy buildings, high performance, happy hearts and minds. We have 10 events in total, 5 Science Talks and 5 debates. The series is developed in collaboration with Build, Aalborg University, Realdania, Velux, Climate, PropTech Denmark, Lys Technologies, and Danish Sound Cluster, and thank you to all of our partners. Today, the part of hearts and minds seems extra pertinent, as we will dive into the realm of how space impacts our mind and health. We've had more than a year with homeschooling and working from home, but what happens neurologically when we're engaged in spatial settings, and how does it impact our health? Those questions and many more are addressed today, relevant and pertinent as we reboard our schools and workplaces. Today's presenters are the eminent researchers from Aalborg University. Zakaria Djebbara is an architect from Aalborg University. He's defended his PhD only last year in the cross-section of architecture, neuroscience and philosophy. Currently engaging in a postdoc at Aalborg University. And with Zakaria, we have Lars Brorson Fick, an associate professor at the Department of Architecture, Design and Media Technology. So we're in very safe hands today. Both Zakaria and Lars are members of Brain-Body Architecture Research Group at Aalborg University. A few practical notes. You may have noticed Helle in the chat. Helle is your chat hostess, and we would love to hear your comments and questions during today's Science Talks. Again, a huge welcome to you all. It is delightful to know that you're with us from near and afar. I hope you'll enjoy the next hour in the presence of Lars, Zakaria, and Space, Body and Brain. Lars and Zakaria, a thank you to you for being with us, and take it away.
Thank you so much for the very nice invitation. So the title for today is Space, Body and Brain. And in the context of, Space, Body and Brain, and the context of healthy buildings. Both Lars and myself will present some results of our ongoing research. Does it work? Yes, great. All right, so yes, in the context of healthy buildings, we would like to turn our attention towards the users of the building. And in doing so, we would also like to turn towards a more biological approach in this sense. So we use the concept of affordances to better understand the complex relationship between the space, body and brain, and how buildings will eventually have an effect on our well-being. So the concept of affordances was coined back in the 70s and 80s by the ecological psychologist Gibson. And in the definition, it is defined as what it offers the animal, what it provides or furnishes, either for good or ill. And it also has to do with the complementarity of the animal and the environment. However, we thought that this definition was perhaps a bit too vague for us to really use in experimental setups. And in that sense, we rely much more on the definition as proposed by Andy Clark, which has more to do with the possibilities for use, intervention, and action that the physical world offers, and the fact that affordances can be determined by the fit between the agent's physical structure, capacities, and skills. And basically here, the agent's physical structure has to do with the human physical structure, for example, that we are bipedal, that we walk on 2 feet, that we have thumbs that we can use to certain things, and that we have eyes, and so on. However, since we have different bodies, we also embody different capacities and skills. Not everyone can use their body in the same way. And in that sense, the affordances is quite literally the relationship between space, body, and brain. And in that sense, also very helpful for us to conduct experiments. So in that sense, today what we will be providing is a more human-centered approach to understanding healthy buildings. And in doing what we do is basically measuring brain and body to better understand the human behavior and capabilities and skills. And one question that basically ties my own research with also Lars's research is how do human beings relate to their immediate environment? So we take quite seriously the concept of affordances in improving our understanding of this very complex relationship between space, body, and brain. And with this, with this definition, there are a number of also biological processes that Lars will elaborate on now.
Yeah, I go back to homeostasis, which is a physiological concept that describes the inner biological balance needed to sustain life. And it's really a very, very basic physiological concept. This is a quotation from one of the first pages of a much used textbook in medical physiology. And it says that in 1929, the American physiologist Walter Cannon coined the term homeostasis to describe the maintenance of nearly constant conditions in the internal environment. Essentially, all organs and tissues of the body performs functions that help maintain these relatively constant conditions. So this is really a very, very basic thing for the organism's way of functioning. And it is, of course, also closely related to health. It also have other implications because in relation to the internal environment and the organism, the external environment often varies dramatically. And that means that any living organism, from the most primitive bacteria to very complex multicellular organisms as we are, somehow must have an interactive relationship to its environment. We must be able to counteract these variations in the external environment. And if we go back to the definition of affordances by Andy Clark that Zakaria just mentioned, this is really about the same thing. It's about the relationship between the agent and the environment, between the, a living organism and its environment. And also, if you look at this triangle that comes from cognitive science that Zakaria mentioned, it's about the same thing. It's about the relationship of an organism represented here by the body and the brain to its environment, in our case, architectural space. And then can we somehow measure this, the impact of of space on homeostasis? And to do this, it's of course would be nice to have a way that we can study homeostasis and provoke it under controlled conditions. And it happens that one definition of stress is actually the term stress describes a state of threatened homeostasis, which means that by studying stress, by finding protocols where we can actually, under controlled conditions, induce stress, we have a way forward perhaps to study this influence on space on homeostasis. Then a few words about stress. Also important, stress has a behavioral component because stress is really a preparation for what's called a fight or flight behavior. It's meant that it causes the organism to recruit resources to fight your way out of trouble or getting away from it, basically. And then there's two different types of stress. The first one is called psychogenic stress, which, as the term implies, stands for psychologically generated stress. And it's when the organism tries to predict if a situation can be threatening, and meaning that it's a way of preparing for something that could happen. And the two strongest stress of this kind is unpredictability, which means that you are not able through your behavior to control the outcome or situation. And the other one is social evaluation, meaning that if you have to perform something in front of a group that has importance, you are socially evaluated by the group, and that means something for your status within the social hierarchy. And that's important because, especially for social animals as us, because it means access to security and resources and so on. Then there's systemic stress, and that is, you could say, that is when something has happened and you feel that something has happened to you, for example, in terms of pain. It could also be that the blood volume drops or something. So that's when something actually has happened. And then there's two stress systems. The one of them is called the HPA axis, and it works through the bloodstream. It releases a hormone cortisol into the bloodstream, and then it spreads throughout the body and has a profound influence on a lot of organs throughout the body. Because it works through the bloodstream, and because the process that leads to the release of cortisol, it's quite slow and sluggish compared to the other one, which is a sympathetic nervous system, which can be activated within milliseconds and, for example, release adrenaline throughout the body. And it can also, it's part of the autonomic nervous system, and it can be shut down by the other part of the autonomic nervous system, the parasympathetic nervous system, in milliseconds as well. So it's a very fast system. Then we were looking for ways to lab protocols where we could actually study stress and find a way to study them with controlled spatial conditions. And we chose to work with this called the Trier Social Stress Test, which has been a standard protocol for studying psychosocial stress or psychogenic stress in lab conditions since the 1990s. And it has shown to be very consistent in its results. And the lab setting actually consists of two spaces, two rooms. And here you can see a picture of a typical test room. And then there is a preparation room as well. And you can see there's a committee of three authoritative looking people that evaluates the test person on his performance. And the protocol goes like, first you take a baseline measurement, and then the test person is called in front of the committee, and is told by the chairman of the committee that he has to perform two tasks. The one is giving a presentation of himself for 5 minutes as if to a job interview where he really would like to have this job, and he's then informed that he will get another task, but not what that task is, and he can then go back to the preparation room and prepare his speech for 5 minutes. Then he's called in front of the committee, and he gives a speech for 5 minutes, and then he's given the other task, and this is a really evil one because he has to count backwards from 1,687 in steps of 13 for 5 minutes. And every time he makes an error, he's told, this was wrong, please do it over again. And the point is this is, of course, that he is socially evaluated on a task that he cannot possibly fulfill. So he will fail this task and feel evaluated on it. And then he can go back and rest for 40 minutes, and you can measure the stress reaction slowly die down. Then we found that at the university in Lund, they had transferred this social stress test to a cave, which is a virtual reality environment where you have three big screens and you have five video projectors that's controlled by a computer, and then you have a head tracking device so the computer can track your line of sight, and you have some special glasses on. And then, of course, you cannot photograph the 3D effect, but I hope you can see the point in the pictures anyway. So because it was in a cave, we could control the spatial conditions very precisely. And we made to address this fight and or flight condition behavior that is kind of a part of the stress. We made a closed room where was no potential possibility for escape. And we made an open room with, I hope you can see it, with big openings onto a completely empty landscape. So basically the floor continued to the horizon and giving potential possibility for escape. And here is a result for the cortisol. I should say that there was no significant difference for any part of the autonomic nervous system or the autonomic nervous system. But here's the cortisol, and it happens that cortisol turns out up in saliva about 10 minutes after it has been released into the bloodstream. And that means that at certain points during the test person has to give a saliva sample that we can then afterwards analyze, that get analyzed, and then we can see the, how the level of cortisol develops. And the lower line here, the dotted line, is the open room, and the upper line, the closed line, is the closed room. And as you can see, there was a significant difference between the two spaces. And also, you can see if one had continued the line set, it would have taken approximately the double time for those who had been in the closed room to get down to their baseline compared to those who had been in the open room. And there was next one. Then we wanted to try with systemic stress in terms of, in this case, pain. And we chose to use what is called a cold pressure test, where you had to put your hand into some cold water, and after just a few minutes, it gets rather painful. And we was also inspired by this quite famous paper by Roger Ulrich, which was published in Science in 1984, where he had studied a patient journal from a hospital for 9 years, and all the patients had been hospitalized in identical patient bedrooms. They all had undergone the same gallbladder surgery, which was a serious thing at that time. Half of them had a view to the hospital block on the opposite side, and half of them to a small park. And it showed up that those who had the view to the park was hospitalized on average a day shorter, and also that they used milder and fewer painkillers. And that make us speculate that it could have something to do with pain stress. And also I should say that cortisol is an immune regulative hormone. It influenced simply the immune system. So we thought that it was reasonable to think that that it could be an effect of of a cortisol release that made the difference. So in this case we made three spatial conditions. We made the closed room, we made an open room, and then we made a room with a view to nature. And then here you can see the result for the cortisol. And the lowest dotted line is nature. And you can see there's virtually no difference between the closed and the open room. And there's actually no significant difference for nature either. You could say on a good day, you could say there's a tendency, but it's not significant. And then this is the result for the sympathetic nervous system. And I should say this curve should be read like the lower the curve, the higher the activation. And the low dotted line is nature. And that was kind of disturbing surprise because there seems to be a general consensus that nature is distressing. But this curve implies that actually nature was the most stressing condition in terms of reaction of the sympathetic nervous system. We of course been speculating why could that be? Does this really disprove all the studies that shows that nature is distressing? It could of course have to do with this is only a very acute situation. It could also be that we have used the wrong kind of nature, so to speak, that there's a difference between natural settings and how they influence the stress system. It could also be a sign not of on stress, but that the activation of the sympathetic nervous system perhaps could have something to do with with attention, and not necessarily is a result of the stress, because there is a theory called a distraction theory that says that when you have a view to something complex like nature, it engages your attention so much that there's not much attention left to actually feeling pain. So it could be something with that, but more research is of course needed to figure out how could that be, or is it some kind of error in the experiment that we have not found out. Then when we go back to Andy Clark's definition of affordances, then we can say that we have tried two different events in basically the same spaces. If you take the closed room and the open room, we tried the psychogenic stress, the social event, with a Trier social stress test, and we tried systemic stress in terms of pain. So there was two different events taking place in basically the same computer-generated spaces, the same model. Also, no participant actually tried to escape, although they got stressed, so their body was preparing for it. So it was the possibility for use, intervention, and action which the physical world offered the agent that made the difference. So, simply the possibility not actually try to escape. So it was a possibility that caused the difference in the level of cortisol for the social event and the lack of difference in the level of cortisol for the physical event. So that means that the two different events actually made a difference, which could mean that maybe Andy Clark should add something about the event that takes place in the environment, so that you have the agent, the environment, and whatever takes place in the environment. Actually, in a way, reminding one of the on the cognitive science triangle. but it also tells something about that, at least under certain conditions, affordances is a situated thing. Then you can say that, of course, this was lab experiments, and we were only able to test acute stress in the lab. And that means that we can say it had, for example, an acute influence on the immune system. it would have an acute influence on memory. Many have probably tried this, that no matter how well prepared you are for an exam, when you get stressed under the exam, suddenly you might not be able to remember something. And also you can say that the advantage of doing a lab, working in the lab, is that you can, as we have shown here, very precisely isolate certain variables that you want to study. And you get the effect sizes rather precisely of those. But we do not know anything about how big or how important those effect sizes is compared to all other kinds of effect sizes that would be in a real world setting. So what we would of course like to do is, yeah, getting out of the lab and also to try to be able to study prolonged or permanent stress, because acute stress is not unhealthy in any way. It's a healthy natural reaction, but prolonged stress is or permanent stress can really cause a lot of serious health problems. It has of course influence on the immune system, and in a more serious way than just the acute one. It's involved in anxiety and depression. If we talk learning environments, for example, it has profound influence on cognitive performance. If you're permanently much stressed, it would lead to something popularly called, for example, a writer's block. It is thought to be involved in obesity, because cortisol has an influence on insulin, and therefore it makes people urged that it will eat hedonic food, and it has an influence on women's menstrual cycle, and it's suspected to have an influence on fertility in women. It can lead to alcohol and drug abuse, because both alcohol and amphetamines directly influence the HPA axis, and also, actually, the list is longer. Some researchers is beginning to talk about that Alzheimer's, for example, can be related to prolonged stress episodes earlier in life. So it's really serious conditions, and if we could find out whether or if and how the built environment, in terms of the buildings that we design and the urban spaces that we design, has an influence on stress, it would of course be a very important step forward in how we can design healthier buildings and healthier cities. And if I can get this to work, yes, then I'll just end my part of it by thanking Valdania and the Obelske Familie Fund for supporting this part of our research, and I'll give the word on to Zakaria.
Yes, thank you so much for that, Lars. And I think that one important implication of Lars's result is that if we try to adjust the body after that some consequence has occurred, then it's simply just too late. So one good strategy is in fact to adjust before something happens. And in that sense, I would like to just go back to the point of departure on homeostatic balance, because I think that the homeostatic balance can be reinterpret in a more mathematical and information theoretical way. So basically, if we look at the homeostatic balance and the whole task of the human body, which is to maintain the homeostatic balance, it basically means that we need to resist this tendency to disorder. So the whole body is continuously into this, trying to balance its state and remain in a steady state, or at least try to approach it, although it never really achieves it. And this whole process of maintaining homeostatic balance corresponds to resisting the second law of thermodynamics. And now the advantage is here that we can, in speaking of thermodynamics, we can introduce the language of physics, which is mathematics. And so we can come up with an information theoretical approach to resisting disorder. And this corresponds to minimizing the free energy by predictions. And now no one really understands what does this mean. What is minimizing free energy and where are these predictions coming from? But basically what I'm talking about here is that the whole information theoretical approach to homeostatic balance is basically what the predictive brain hypothesis is based on. And this hypothesis is basically stating that the brain and the body are continuously generating a lot of top-down predictions about the environment. And these top-down predictions are met by bottom-up prediction errors. And so you have to imagine that there is sometimes a divergence between the top-down signal and the bottom-up prediction error. And for us, in order for us to truly adapt to our environment, we need to minimize this this divergence in order for them to come closer and therefore adapt our body to the environment. And this particular process, there you go, this particular process has been summed up as an active inference framework. So basically what it says is that we adapt by predicting the actions that cause favorable sensations. So if I'm cold right now, and I also understand that I'm in an environment that is in shade, and I realize that there is a spot over there in which there is sunlight, then I will have to predict the actions that will cause that I can actually get over there and get the favorable sensations of getting heated by the sun. And in that sense, we understand perception is thus those afforded actions. So if there is no challenge for my body to go from this shadowed place to a more sunlighted space, then it's an affordable action, and so I will most likely unfold. I will most likely go there. And in this, in the context of affordances, then we should be able to reformalize the whole idea of affordances as embodied predictions. And also, it's maybe even easier to understand when I put it like that, that affordances are basically embodied predictions. We predict that we can act in certain ways in this environment, and therefore they are action possibilities. But from this from this hypothesis of the predictive brain, we can derive an important hypothesis. That is that we should be able to measure systematic changes in the sensory motor regions of the brain, and they should be reflecting these affordances in the architecture in parallel with perception. Because in this hypothesis, we're basically saying that our perceptual processes and our action possibilities are more or less the same process. In fact, they are the same process, just looked at from different ways, and therefore have different functions. So in order for me to test this hypothesis, of course, I had to conduct an experiment. And here is an example of what my participants looked like when they were doing this experiment. I gave my participants mixed reality. So basically, it's basically virtual reality. So they would be wearing these big goggles, and they were wearing this backpack that held in the computer and the amplifier of the EEG system. So an EEG system is short for electroencephalogram. And basically, I thought that maybe the best way to show what it is that it's basically this big cap, sort of like a belly hood, like a bathing cap, and you put it on top of the participant's head, and you have all of these channels that are filled in with gel, and they are basically collecting all the synaptic activity. So it's a neural discharge that we can collect from the scalp. And basically these discharges that we measure are happening inside the brain, and there's a certain amount of neurons that have to discharge at the same time for us to be able to pick up the signal. But once we pick up the signal, we can basically process the whole signal, and we will get some interesting features that happens in different areas of the brain. So for example, a barely processed signal is what you see in the top, the blue one. But once you start filtering the signal, you can extract certain features. The frequency bandwidth, for example, in the yellow one is the theta, and the next one, the Turkish, the bluish one is the alpha band, and the last one in the bottom is the beta band. And basically, we can use all these different frequencies to understand better what is happening in the brain. So with this setup, we basically have a paradigm in which we can control what the participants are looking at in terms of virtual environment while synchronizing the brain activity with that. And that gave us a lot of freedom and a lot of important insights to how architecture or how the built environment affects our brain. So in the paradigm that I built is basically all my participants would start from one space and they were instructed to go from this one space into another space. In that transition, they would be obstructed by a door. And this is what you see in the S1, in the top left one in the diagram. Basically, what happens is that they are completely in a pitch black darkness because there's a black sphere around their head. And at some point, this black sphere just pops. And once it pops, they're presented with the type of door that they have to pass. And there is one of three doors that they can pass that they are presented with. And these are the types of doors you see in the bottom line of the diagram there. So the wide door is 1.5 meters wide and is easily passable. Then the mid-sized door in the middle is 1 meter wide and is also passable. But the narrow door is only 20 centimeters wide and is absolutely impossible for them to pass. So, and they learn this after a couple of trials, of course. But basically the paradigm is such that they are looking at this door and now they're either facing the wide size, the mid-size, or the narrow door, and they still have to wait for this go signal or no go signal, which basically is when the door turns green or red. So for the sake of this explanation, let's say the door is now turning green, and this is what you see in the S2 of the diagram. And then if they get the green door, basically they approach the door slides open, there's a red circle floating in the second space, and they have this controller in which they can touch, and they can go touch the red circle, and then they have to go back to the first space. They answer a questionnaire and they basically pull the trigger and they are back into this black sphere waiting for the next trial, which could be either the same door or a new door. And they had to do this 240 times, so you can imagine it's quite tiresome. So once you pick up all the signals of the brain at the moment that this sphere pops, which is basically the exact moment that they realize that they are in a space and they're looking at a specific type of door, we can average all the signals from the different electrodes. And in this case, I'm presenting signals from the FCZ, as you can see in the top one. And the FCZ is basically the channel that reflects activity over the motor area of the brain. And the OZ, which is in the bottom, is reflecting the collected activity from the visual processing area of the brain in the back. So basically what we see here is that already at after 140 milliseconds, we're able to see that there are significant differences between the way that the different doors are being processed. And in all my cases, I'm able to see that all the that it's always only the narrow door, that is the door that do not afford to being passed, is simply processed differently. And the process between, well, basically 0 milliseconds until around 300 milliseconds are typically called the perceptual processes. So what's interesting here is that we are able to tell that there is motor information in the perceptual process already at 140 milliseconds. So that's quite fast. And of course, we studied also, so let's say that you're standing in front of this door and now you're waiting for the go or no go cue. So we collected all the go cues and basically we're asking them, yes, you have to interact with this door. And again, we see a significant difference in the way that the narrow door exclusively is processed. So I was met with a lot of criticism about this because no one is ever really just going from pitch black darkness into a space and this is how we meet space. No, that's true, but this is also one of the limitations of doing a lab experiment. So instead, what I wanted to do instead of looking at the static transformation was that to look into the continuity, right? So the continuous experiment, are there any architectural affordances reflected in the brain as we continue to perceive it or interact with it? And in that sense, I started looking into source localization of the different signals, and I filtered out all the independent components that I could not use because they did not show any significant difference for my conditions. And I started looking into some time frequency plots and analysis. And basically what you see here in the plot above is that the horizontal direction, the x-axis, is basically showing us the time, and the y-axis is showing us the different frequencies that we have decomposed the signal to. And what's interesting here is that the moment that people perceive the door, we are able to see a very strong alpha activity continuously pressing down. And we see that the variation is always exclusively for the narrow condition that we find the we find the significance. And we find the exact same thing. So in this plot here is actually backwards. So the purple dotted line that you see on the right is basically where they physically pass the threshold. And then we look backwards, what happens up until you actually pass the threshold. And once again, we see a very strong alpha activity that also differs only for the narrow condition. So I'm just trying to sum up real quick here about this. I'm leaving a lot of things out here, so I can understand if people are a bit confused about it. So I will just jump to the conclusions now from these two types of analysis. The first is that the whole question about how can I move, we show is an inherent part of what do I perceive. At least this is how the brain processes it. And that has huge implications for the way that we want, if we want to change the user experience and their whole perception of the space, well, in that sense, you should change the way that people have the possibility to move. So in other words, the sensory signals and action potentials are processed in parallel. That was for the first analysis that I showed. For the second one on the continuity, we show that the brain is continuously influenced by the architectural affordances. And here I think that this is an important conclusion. It states that users of space hold a principle of anticipation that architects should keep in mind when designing the context of actions, which basically is exactly what buildings are. They are context of possible actions, and they have a continuous influence on us. So putting all this together, we learn that this current state of the body and the brain, it alters the upcoming performance and experience. And in many ways, we have to understand, for example, that the pre-stimulus alpha, so you saw that the alpha was increasing as people approached the transition, the door, and that increase in alpha will actually have a lot of impact on the way that you're going to experience the upcoming space, and also in the way that you're going to interact with that space. There's a lot of studies that I just show here showing that the pre-stimulus alpha is inherently related to our performance and experience. And to give an example of how to think of that particular conclusion is that if you're low on energy and you're looking at the dishes, you look at them in a certain way, in one way at least. But if you're full of energy and you look at the very same dishes, you look at them in a different way. So our current state of the body, and also in my case, I show here that it's the current state of the alpha frequency in the brain, will have an impact on the performance and experience of the upcoming space. So with that, I think the next steps of our ongoing research is, of course, that we have quite reductionistic approaches right now because we're working in a lab and there are certain limitations that we would like to overcome. So our next steps would have to be to go out and investigate the effects of social events, the built environment, urban spaces, as well as urban planning, to truly situate our knowledge about how the built environment affects the brain and the body. And I think those were my last words. Thank you very much.
Guys, a huge round of applause. I wish, of course, that we were together because you would be able to monitor how my brain has been working very hard during your presentation. But B, also, I think you would see me being extremely smiling a lot, and I have a ton of questions. First of all, really, thank you. I think this is very, very interesting. And Zach, you had me when you said, so now we have the ability to calculate this mathematically. This is always very interesting because once we have mathematics, we're able to come with basic recommendations of how to create the perfect space, right? That was my line of thought. But then I was thinking, and last, this is where you come into the picture, because you were describing intricate levels of stress measured also in a lab situation, and where it became quite clear that you had this small line where you say stress is sometimes not a bad thing. Now, if I'm trying to combine what you said in that sentence, with SAC in terms of now we have the mathematical ability to measure how we feel. I put a sensory a value to the formula. If, and here comes my question, you're interested in healthy buildings, and what we're able to ascertain from your tests is actually that sometimes we do not feel healthy given the environment we're in. But if you were to combine the healthy level of stress with what you have now demonstrated, SAC, what would be your recommendation on a healthy building? Like, what is a healthy building to you?
So who are you asking?
I was thinking, huh, I would like to see you battle. I'll ask you for a second, then I'll let last comment afterwards.
All right. I think that's a very good question, and also a superb observation, because so once we work with the mathematical description of homeostatic balance, we tend to think that there is an optimal grip about it, that there is like a top point of how we should design our buildings, and then we would eventually end up with a measurably perfect space. But I think this is a misconception, because most of what I show is actually that we are continuously changing. We're always in change, and we need sometimes the, like also Lars is talking about, stress is in fact a good thing, because it actually keeps you awake. It keeps you doing things, and it makes you put in the effort. And in the very same sense, I think to give a recommendation, what we show here is that action possibilities in the environment are inherently part of our brain activity. And when I talk about brain activity, I'm talking about neurotransmitter activity, and that can be a lot of different things. So to give a recommendation, I think that we need to take seriously the action possibilities, even if we notice them explicitly or just implicitly.
It's a very, very good question, wonderful comment, and it ties in with another question I have, so I'll get back to that, but thank you very much. And Lars, if you were to add to what Zakaria has said, what would be your recommendation to a healthy building?
I can say at the point where we are now, I guess what also Zakaria has been talking about is that we get more, getting more and more aware of how the possibilities to move or to behave in a building has an importance. I would also say that I think that one should be kind of humble to this question. I remember when I in early phases of my PhD, I imagined that you could build a mathematical model that you could actually calculate how many openings compared to other factors to create a certain impact of a space. And I now think that it's quite more complex than that. But that doesn't affect that this points to that the possibility to act within a building has an effect, and that is important, and it's basically that actually our ability to act has a much more profound influence on us than we imagine so intuitively. And about the healthy or the good stress, I would say that it's important to understand that cortisol there's always a natural level of cortisol, and it varies throughout the day. In the morning, just 10 minutes or so before you wake up, the cortisol level rises high up, and then it falls slowly throughout the day. So after midday, maybe some people has experienced that you suddenly have you suddenly would like to have a piece of chocolate or something. That's because the cortisol is low, so the blood sugar level is low. So there's a natural variation of cortisol throughout the day, and the variations that I'm talking about, that the stress is kind of diverse, when it's diverse in compared to that. And then, because we're also talking about learning environments, an important part of the brain for memory, creating memory and understanding and remembering something, and therefore also for the cognitive performance, is the hippocampus. And especially that, there's also other parts of the brain that has it, but especially that has a lot of cortisol receptors. And there's two different kinds of them, easy to remember, because they're called type 1 and type 2. And there's a kind of inverse U curve. If you get a little stressed, then the type 1 receptors is saturated. And when you are on the top of the curve, things is really in flow. It's fun. You work effectively and so on. If you slide down the curve, if you get more and more cortisol into your blood, then you end in what you could describe as a writer's block. You really want to solve what you should, but you can't. And in the other end, where you also in down in zero, where you have very low cortisol in the blood, it's like you cannot engage you. It's like Sunday afternoon on the sofa. So a bit of stress actually make you cognitive more efficient.
But you're touching upon some really interesting points here. And there was one thing in terms of because the learning environment is interesting. And throughout your presentation, one thing that I was thinking about, you had the point about that nature surprisingly wasn't as influential as could have been predicted. There were other factors that actually had a greater influence on the level. So that was one thing that leads me to my next question, because the learning environments today, you know, you have these buzzwords that are floating about, and we need to create a co-collaborative learning space, a creative space. So all of these various factors that we have in those spaces tend to relate to open spaces, bring nature in, lots of different artifacts surrounding the people. And one of the things I was thinking about, given your presentation, that I took away from it was also the aspect of being able to navigate. You basically, both of you addressed the point that your test people responded best when they felt they were able to navigate. You had it from USAC, used the top down and bottom up, where I literally felt that body and brain and body were intertwined, and that we instinctively don't know what is going on as we process the space, but that we're literally navigating with our brain in terms of the predictive reaction, and then the body reading the room, as it were. And the ability to read that room and feel powerful in navigating the room is what I took from your presentation. But you also addressed that, Lars, with the 3D, the virtual reality experiment. And I wanted to ask you, in terms of, this is interesting that you are able to demonstrate neurologically that there are certain factors that have to be in play for people to stay positive, and a willingness to respond proactively. So if we take that into our learning context, the learning environment, what would your recommendation be to all of these educational institutions that are spending millions of kroners trying to create a good learning environment? And I know it's a complex question, but still, if we move away from the buzzwords, what would you say we should focus on? And I'll let Lars go first, and a short answer, and then to Zakaria, and then you can maybe elaborate, yeah? Please, thank you.
It's difficult.
Isn't that a nice job?
as you said, basically it's a question of the system trying to keep the body, your organism, safe. So as long as getaway routes that you can see that makes it sure for your kind of subconscious system, or outside the consciousness system, that if something should happen, you are able to escape. That would at least be one recommendation. And I should also add about that the nature experiment was only with pain. We have not done it with psychosocial stress yet.
Okay, interesting. Because you see in a lot of creative environments, they say bring in nature, that'll stimulate people positively. So I was really curious when you presented your test result. So Zach, your recommendation to a conducive learning environment, what should be in focus?
I think that's an excellent question, but it's also very, very difficult to provide an answer to. What I can instead is provide some philosophy that I work with, and it's also very evident in my work, and it is on affordances, of course. So there are certain design features that are more enticing and more inviting, in the sense that a door invites walking through, much less a window. And so I understand that all of these affordances are continuously processed in the brain and always have an impact on our cognitive performances. In this sense, in order to really provide to create an environment that invites learning and invites creativity, what I think is important is to have an environment that continuously stimulates and always is situated in the sensory motor interaction, right? Because generally the way that we understand the world is through this dependency between sensory information and motor commands, so actions, right? In that sense, I think the best advice that I could give, and again, this is not a concrete answer to that very difficult question, it is to have environments that have competing affordances, so that not only a specific feature of the environment is the most interesting one. For example, it could be nature. So it's only that part of the environment that is completely interesting. Instead, what is important is that you have competing affordances in such a way that you don't get too narrow-sighted and only look at one thing, because creativity in the end is about being open to many other solutions. And in this sense, I think that different affordances are much better.
I think it's really fascinating, and we could go on for hours, and unfortunately we're getting close to the end. But I have one final thing, because we've had a science talk on air, we've had a science talks on light, and two of the interesting aspects from those scientific presentations were the following. The importance of air and light are as important as what you have demonstrated today in terms of space. Two, we as human beings within the building with regards to light and air, we don't realize the negative effect light or air, the lack of light or a poor quality air, what the effects are on us till we are suffering. So the typical headache syndrome, as it were. But what you're demonstrating here today is that I quite quickly, as a human being, will sense that I'm in a space that has a and when I say negative, I don't mean it that I get sick necessarily, but that I get more alert. Could that be a phrasing? And I think that to me, that is an interesting difference in terms of the spatial impact on my well-being, that when I am not when I don't feel able to navigate, or as you said, a getaway route, have a door so I can leave the room if I'm uncomfortable, I think, just to paraphrase you. But would that be an accurate description of the impact of space on us, that we actually feel it quite quickly, that it has an effect on us? Lars?
About the interplay between our research and, for example, indoor climate research, I would like to say that we have just before the lockdown, we were engaged in transferring this this experiment from the cave to VR, Google's, And one of the what I was dreaming about is that, for example, to be able to do this stress experiments in a climate lab to see how the interplay is between the spatial experience and, for example, the temperature of the air in the space or the indoor climate. I don't know if that answers your question.
It does. There is definitely a correlation, but am I right in observing that I feel the spatial, my interpretation of space is more immediately felt by my body and brain?
Okay. But it's also in Zakaria's department, so to speak.
Yeah, he's that, nodding. It's very nice.
The effect is happens within a few hundred or 200 milliseconds after you experience something, but it only, you know, the your consciousness is locked. It's something that only turns up in consciousness after 400 to 500 milliseconds. So all this kind of happens long before you get conscious of it.
It's just, and Zak, I'd actually let you comment on it as well, because I think this is, I think for the audience, is something that is very nice. I know I have educationalists sitting there thinking, how do we design the room? And I think it's a important key takeaway that the students and us as people, just human beings, will actually, we will sense the room, the spatial environment quite quickly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So there's two things to this, actually. Yes, exactly. You experience your action possibilities as part of your perception of space. So there is no distinction between these processes. It's basically the same thing. The whole process of you understanding the environment is, in fact, to understand the action possibilities. So this can be demonstrated in many ways. Just for example, looking at a cup, for example, although you can't see the backside of the cup, you still have an experience of its presence. And this presence is rooted in the action possibility that you know what to do, which is basically to turn around the cup in order to see the backside that you cannot see. So there is always action possibilities in everything that we perceive. So I would even go even further and be even more radical about the conclusion of that. It's not to say that there is only a sense of navigation when you very, very early in your perception. No, it's in fact part of the perception. It is part of the way that you perceive the whole environment. And the second part to this is that, so basically all our sensory information is gathered and collected in in an organ in the brain called the thalamus. The thalamus is basically where all our sensory information goes up further and is starts to compete with our predictions, the top-down predictions. Of course, only the olfaction, so basically the nose and the way that things smell, is not part of that that collection. But everything else, so like visual information, taste, haptic information, heat, and so on and so on, all go through the same part. An inherent implication from very early on from the motor commands and action possibilities. So what does this mean? This means that when you are in space and you're looking at and you are in that space, right, the action possibilities of that space will have an impact on the way that you also experience thermal conditions. You also have an impact in the way that you're going to experience the CO2 levels. All of these things are intrinsically related, and this is what complicates things even further and what we need to continue to experience on.
It was the absolute perfect last comment to what has been an absolutely formidable introduction to neurological research when it comes to the human being's ability to navigate space. And also, I think from a philosophical point of view, as you mentioned yourself, Zak, that you've actually studied philosophy, it also demonstrates again that the human being is not only a complex entity, but that we're also in constant conflict with ourselves, because we would like to predict what comes next, but it is also the balance of being challenged that we have to go into the unknown is also good for us, because otherwise we don't know what comes next the next time we experience it. So it's not easy to create that wonderful learning or working environment. It's not easy to create that perfect space and there may not be one perfect space, but certainly what you have shown us today is that there are still some basic rules that we, or principles that we need to bring into our design of spaces, and that is to ensure the action of possibilities for every human being in that space. To bring it down to a one-liner, there has to be a getaway route. I like that. With that, I will also say that we continue this topic of space next week when we have a debate where we're looking at the spatial ability to heal. So we're taking this very amazing research into the context of healing spaces. So I hope I'll see you next week as well, where we'll be back. To Lars and Zakaria, a huge round of applause. Absolutely impressive and extremely inspiring. Thank you for being with us today. I hope to see you again. And just really thank you from all of us here at BlocksUp. And thank you to all of you watching and participating today. It was an absolute pleasure to have you with us. Thank you.